Good evening and welcome to the Earnings Review, your tidbits into company financials and operational insights. Thank you for joining us as we broadcast from Hampton Studios in Harare, Zimbabwe. I'm Ibn Mabunda, your money man. On the show, we engage top echelon executives to catch up to speed with first-hand information. We also ensure that you've got comprehensive market analysis as we bring onto the show competent market analysts. Tonight, we focus on British American Tobacco Zimbabwe, a listed firm on the Zimbabwe Stock Exchange, which is as well the leading tobacco manufacturer in Zimbabwe by, of course, market share. The BAT manufactures, distributes, and sells tobacco products for local consumption through a network of independent retailers and distributors. BAT Zim is part of the BAT group of companies and has been operational in Zimbabwe for over 80 years. Founded in 1902, the group has a global presence employing more than 50,000 people around the world, operating in over 180 markets globally. The group's headquarters are in London and the company is listed on the London Stock Exchange. Back in Zimbabwe, on the cards is the half-year results for BAT Zimbabwe, as well as some key management appointments that have taken place over the past 6 months. Now, joining me for a conversation where these developments are concerned is the Equity Access Chief Analyst, Respect Kwenzi. Respect, good evening and thank you for joining us on the Earnings Review.
Thank you, Iben. As always, it's my pleasure.
Fantastic. To sort of cut to the chase, of course, this, as I mentioned earlier, this conversation is coming shortly after the results presentation for BAT Zimbabwe for their half-year performance. But perhaps before we delve into those particular results, can you give us the macroeconomic landscape on which we're having this conversation tonight?
Thank you, Iben. So I think to just give a brief background in terms of the operating environment, that is the macroeconomic key indicators. If you look at the inflation environment, it has really subsided significantly. We closed the month of September with an inflation figure of, the month of August with an inflation figure of about 50%. That is in line with government's own target. The month-on-month inflation is also hovering within the same range, plus minus 5%. When you look at the monies that have moved on the interbank, which is our market for the exchange of US dollars, we have seen almost $2 billion moving between June of last year, to date. But most of the money has moved in the current year compared to last year. So this has enabled a more of a stable environment against which companies are operating. So companies have been able to import some of their raw material requirements, import machinery, and obviously this has kind of pushed production up. You also look at 2021 as a year where, after which we have had a very good season. And what that means is a good agricultural season has resulted in improved agri yields across different crops. So we have quite a stable environment relative to last year. Of course, the current environment has got its own weaknesses, but generally companies have been able to operate in a more stable environment compared to last year. What we saw last year were these hyperinflationary numbers, and those have since subsided, and these always causes companies to scale back in terms of production, whereas demand as well also subsides as purchasing power goes down.
Quite a colorful picture there. Now let's just get into some of the details from their results presentation there, and the new finance director Vincent Kaloki takes us through some of the details. Let's have a listen.
So I'll start off with our F1 2021 performance. All the parameters measured. Our sales volume was up by 27%, recorded 569 million sticks. Our contribution to the government coffers was also up 379%. Our revenues, we recorded revenues of up to $1.4 billion, which represented a 63% increase. Profit after tax, an increase over 200%. We recorded a profit of 470. We also had an increase in our exports to cataract tobacco to some of the our sister companies. Our earnings per share are also healthy, just in line with our profit recorded for the period under review. Moving on, just to give you a snapshot of our volume performance in terms of cigarette sales, we saw a 27% increase over same period last year in 2020. And as you can see, month on month, we recorded higher sales than previous period. I would like to highlight in April, if you recall, last year is when we first had the lockdowns, the hard lockdowns. And as you can see there, we had a big impact in April 2019. But 2020, but this year, I must say, we've seen the COVID-19 guidelines being lost a bit. So we've managed to push a bit more volume. Business operating hours have kind of increased and sharing the lives of our partners as well as our employees. For cartridge tobacco sales, we also have seen an increase in the number of cages exported. As at June, we had exported to close to 213,000 cages. Moving on to the other the income statement. So I've shown two columns there. The first column is the inflation adjusted numbers, while the second column is historical cost numbers. On inflation adjusted, also showing quite a good growth, right from revenues, which grew up by 63%. Main drivers for the growth is we've taken in the second half of last year, as well as the volume growth, as you saw in the previous slide. Again, our cost of sales, we saw an increase, and again, this is inflation-driven, as well as the purchase of, remember, it's a requirement that portion of your leaf you purchase in dollars, so it's aligned to the movement in the exchange rates. Our operating costs slightly lower. We managed to keep in check our operating costs. Overall, profit after tax, we recorded a 200% increase. Or historical costs, just to give you, and here we look at the ratios versus our net turnover to see how we are doing versus how our revenues are. And I can say most of the ratios are relatively flat versus last year, just to give you an indication of how we are doing. And the most important ratio, which is profit after tax, you can see we've actually versus the same period last year. Moving on to our balance sheet, we saw our non-current assets increase versus the same period last year. Actually, it's a decrease, and it's mainly due to some the items which we kind of disposed of. Our inventories versus the same period last year have also reduced. Moving on to the equity side, increase in the equity by the profit number. So mainly driven by our profitability, which is pegged on the additional volume, additional revenues from the pricing. The other lines are relatively flat. Total equity and liabilities slightly higher, mainly driven by the good performance we achieved in the first half of the year. Moving on to our cash position, as at 31st of December 2020, in our bank, we had a total value of 123 million Zim dollars. And during the period, we've managed to generate cash from operations up to 876 million Zim dollars. And out of that, we've managed to purchase a capex worth 6 million Zim dollars, as well as pay interest and tax up to tune of 186 million Zim dollars. The cash we are holding as at end of 30th June was 806 million Zim dollars.
Equity Live presents the complete online interactive presentation solution. Hosting AGMs, media, and analyst briefings has never been this simple, efficient, and affordable. Communicate globally through a combination of high-definition video and your prepared multimedia presentation from any location of your choice. Interact with your invited participants from all over the world in question and answer sessions and voting sessions in real time on our safe, secure, and affordable platform. Contact Equity Live for a free customized demonstration. Equity Live, real-time presentation solutions.
Vincent Kaloki, they're giving us some of the details from their results presentation. And let's just get into some of those figures and perhaps interrogate to understand and derive meaning from their revenue. They're scaling 63% to 1.38 billion Zimbabwean dollars for the half year, of course, boosted by a 27% surge in as far as their sales volumes were concerned. What can we read from these particular movements?
Yeah, so I think they were quite particular in terms of explaining how we arrived at that kind of growth. We do have got sales volume growth. We also have got price appreciation or price adjustments upwards. We also have got the exports. They went back to push exports of cataract into the region. So obviously that generated a bit of dollars, and given the exchange rate parity, you then find those earnings contributing significantly, not significantly, but rather meaningfully to these overall results. So we've got a combination of these factors. But if you were to look at the most significant of those, this is volumes growth. And volumes growth is on the backdrop of what we mentioned earlier, to say demand has resurged. It has resurged because production is generally increasing, and earnings or disposable incomes are also improving. So we have got this growth in volumes that is coming as a result of these factors. But also, I would hasten to say, we are coming off a very low base, and hence that double-digit growth, which I don't think is just unique to BAT, but to almost all the companies that are listed on the stock market.
Now, in as much as there's been growth where revenue is concerned, there's also been a significant surge where their costs are concerned. The sales and marketing costs surging 92% to 80 million Zimbabwean dollars. Admin expenses increasing 168% to 174 million Zimbabwean dollars. Then you've got a profit that is up by about 200% to 31 million Zimbabwean dollars. What's the breakdown then? What's your assessment of the movements where the costs are concerned vis-a-vis what we're then seeing at the bottom line?
So I think two key things when you look at the cost function, we have the implication of salary adjustments. Most companies are now moving to realign the cost structures where salaries are concerned, in line with the prices that are prevailing.
Right.
So you have companies trying to close the gap and push salaries towards where they were before we de-dollarized. But of course, that's happening in the local unit, I mean, in the local currency. So these adjustments are coming in hard, and they are chewing in a significant portion of the expenses. So likewise, it's not unique to BAT. We're seeing it market-wide, whereas to retain capacity, human capital within a certain operation, you really have to attend to those. Otherwise, you end up suffering loss of employees given those low salaries. So I think this is exactly what led to that growth in the salary component of the business. Then you have got another aspect where operationally they've tried to reconfigure their route to market. And this meant realigning how they get to the consumer. And by so doing, you're investing more in research and development. You're also, investing more in terms of operationalizing the plan that you have. So this led to a growth in the cost function. Then we also know that there is an RTGS component of some of their costs.
Right.
And you have suppliers who are requesting to adjust their costs in line with the parallel market exchange rate. So I think all these factors militated to drive the cost function of the company up. But beyond that point, we see the company enjoying monetary gains. These are gains that are as a result of their holding, their USD holdings in terms of bank balances and so forth. So I think that's why we then see the profit position jumping by a very serious margin.
Respect. Let's take a bite-sized snapshot at some of their product segments. You've got their premium segment, which is where you've got the Dunhill. Then you've also got the value for money, where you have got Madison as well as Everest. And lastly, you've got the low value, where you find the Ascot product. Of late, the trend has been, of course, a reduction in as far as the premium brands, as there is a decline and a decrease in as far as the what the average consumer has to spend out on the market, of course, due to inflationary pressures and a whole lot of issues playing out in Zimbabwe. What's your assessment of their key value drivers where their products are concerned going forward?
So the mainstay of the business historically has always been the mainstream segment, where you find your Madison and Everest brands. But then when you then look in an inflationary environment or in a volatile environment such as the one that Zimbabwe has been experiencing, we tend to see an outward movement where the top end, which is your premium segment, kind of holds, and then the value segment also holds. So the mainstream normally suffers whenever there are these movements. I think, for example, you would take Delta, where they do have got the premium brands, the mainstream, as well as the value. So whenever the situation is tight economically, you have people moving to value brands such as Sorghum Beer or Chibuku Super. And then you also have got the upper end sticking to their consumption. So normally the top end of the market kind of holds, because these are really the few among us who have got high spend. But the mainstream always suffers, because these are generally people whose incomes are affected by the vagaries of the economy. So for BAT, we do have got this similar trends or similar segments as well. But when you look at the numbers, you see that they've brought back some of the premium brands that they had neglected a few years ago, and obviously this meant to brought back growth in terms of revenue. Then you've got the mainstream area, where now as demand resurges, people push towards the mainstream brands, and as a consequence, you also find that whenever there's that movement, they're actually coming from the low end to the right to the middle. So I think this also speaks to margins. Why? Because low value brands have got low margins, whereas middle to upper segments have got better or higher margins. So you have got a firm that is moving into the profitable territory as the economy also shifts.
Now let's talk about the impact of the agricultural season. This has been quite a fruitful one, with the rains that were last received way back in 1984, and as far as the records there. Now, and resultantly, we've also seen an uptake with regards to the volumes that have come through at the tobacco auction floors. What would be the relevance or the impact of such a movement in as far as the operations of BAT are concerned?
Yeah, so I think it's really important, the dynamics around the local production of tobacco. 2021 so far has been a very good year. It's likely to surpass the prior year in terms of performance. But I think when you really look at the impact in terms of uptake by BAT, BAT is not involved in the production, which means it simply procures for the purpose of its own production. So I want to think that whenever you increase your production levels as a country, you are equally lowering the cost at which those that are buying to process are going to procure it. But I think the dynamics around tobacco globally has always been that the price is set by international buyers who come in either through merchants or otherwise. So I think BAT has got less in terms of influence. So BAT is a price taker. Why? Because you've got your big companies such as China Tobacco Company, who kind of influences the price from a global perspective. So I don't think that the production dynamics in Zimbabwe have got a bearing in terms of what BAT tends to produce or their buying price and so forth. But generally, it's a positive to find out a tobacco sector that's quite improving. It also guarantees that in future they're likely to continue to get their supplies in terms of raw materials. So that's my take on it.
Right. This also comes amid environmental concerns at a global scale, with a lot of advocacy that is taking place against the use of tobacco as a product. In the foreseeable future, perhaps in the medium term, what do you think would be the impact in general, in as far as the whole industry is concerned?
Yes, so there is a paradigm shift that's taking place in the tobacco sector generally. The consumption of tobacco is obviously being mainly decampaigned, and we are seeing a movement towards electric cigars of sort, which are health positive, so to say. So this has got a long-term implication on the prospects of companies such as BAT. But I think if you are following global trends, you would realize that at a global scale, BAT, the parent company, which is listed on the London Stock Exchange, is already involved in the research and development and trying to see ways of how to hop on to this coming wave of a shift towards electric cigars and other alternative forms of cigarettes as well. So I think it's going to be a gradual process. I don't think it's a once-off move. It's like the EV movement, where you are projecting that possibly by 2030 you would find half of the total cars that are on the road being electric, and so forth and so forth. And I think what can possibly precipitate those movements is possibly government regulation, which can be instituted to speed up the process. So, for example, the European Union has come of late to just say, by such a time, all countries should reduce their emissions by this much. And also, you know, it also speaks to the production of vehicles as well. So I think this is going to be the same route that we are likely to see in the tobacco sector, where consumption will gradually decrease in line with regulation.
Now, to bring it back home here, we have a situation where, not a situation rather, but a development that very regard, where we've seen the appointment of key individuals into managerial posts. We've got Vincent Kaloki, who comes in as the finance director, Phyllis Chengera, who comes in as the company secretary. And mind you, Naidu will be reaching 2 years this coming October. With these shifts, are we likely to expect perhaps a strategic shift that is associated with those?
Yeah, I think the issue of staff turnaround at managerial level at BAT, I think to me it reflects the dynamic nature of a big organization which has got a wider pool of potential managers. They have got a robust training program. Over the years, they have produced some of the, you know, brilliant minds that have set Africa on a different trajectory, either at company level or through their contributions in some other areas. So I think they have got enough arsenal to keep on producing the best people that can take over whenever there is need. If you look over the past few years, there was Lavu Manata, succeeded by Clara Mlambo, and now we've got the new CE. And all these have been part of the organization. But I think this turnaround, or this staff turnover levels at managerial position, sometimes if an organization is kind of independent or does not have a parent company, it might really result in a change in terms of strategy. But for a company like BAT, you would expect less changes in terms of strategy. Why? Because normally strategy is tapped from the parent's position, unlike a situation where you are running an entity which does not have a parent. And also, failure to realign the local operation with the parent expectation can also drive high turnover levels at managerial level, I think you would it would come to mind that recently we saw the CE for Lafarge leaving barely 2 years after coming on board. And the previous CEO also had a very short stint there. So what all this just tells you is that it's very difficult to align a local unit to a parent's expectations, especially in the current macroeconomic environment. It's really difficult to meet your targets. It's difficult to turn around companies, that is, if there is need to turn around. But for BAT, I think they won't change strategy, and that they would have capable hands to position the company for further growth.
Crystal clear. But just before we wrap up, BBC is reporting some investigations that are suggesting that there was some corruption that took place between BAT and the Mugabe administration dating back to about 2013. Should we be worried? Could that still perhaps be happening? What's your assessment of that story that is developing there?
Yeah, I think this is purely a political question. I think most companies do engage in some of these activities, but these are purely not in the best interests of the investment community. So obviously, it's an unfortunate thing if it's ever gonna be proven that they did engage in such. But Africa is a very difficult terrain. I'm sure there are a whole lot of maneuvers. If you read some sections of the press, you would realize that even Strive Masiwa, despite the differences with the current, with the ZANU-PF government, he has been actually involved in also spending on ZANU-PF as part of their, you know, pushing up their elections. So I think it's a murky terrain. Sometimes you do what's necessary to survive. But as a matter of ethics, this is not the way. But Africa is not Europe, and therefore some of these guys tend to cut the corners. But it's not a sustainable way of managing business. It's also not desirable for investors. I think you would eventually get to discount a company's share price if you note that they have got a behavior of such nature. But I think, you know, BAT has been here for the longest possible time. And my own take is that they're not going to move from Zim anytime soon. And obviously, some of these maneuvers are really meant to cement their position in the current state, and obviously living within some of the realities. But it's not really a good thing if it's ever proven to be true.
A bit of a touchy and sensitive subject there. But that's a crystal clear picture right there. And that's a wrap from the Equity Access team here. Don't forget to like, subscribe, follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and to visit our website, www.equityaccess.net. Remember to catch us every Wednesday, 7 p.m. Central African time on this very same platform. From the Equity Access team and I, Donkey, until next time, stay safe.